history. The 7 days to a week. And today is Tuesday, so we can all predict with high accuracy what day tomorrow will be. And we can do that because every week, Wednesday follows Tuesday. There are 24 hours to a day. And so we already know that at 11 o'clock at night, an hour later, it's going to be midnight. No one plan, no sane person plans an outside picnic for midnight. Because we know well in advance that it's going to be dark at midnight. And so there's a cyclical pattern to history. So one of the things we will see about millennials is that they're really not different. It's just that they're looking for things to appear in a different way. And that's going to be a key point. For instance, many of us would acknowledge, and I'm in that trend, where for us, our expectation was that the pastor would have a suit and tie. I remember in the early days of my ministry meeting some pastors who would cut their yard with a tie on. Because they believe that the preacher's supposed to have a tie on. Well, now you got a whole other generation that's not attracted to that. And we'll look at the reasons why. That one, we looked for from the pulpit a father figure. They're looking more for a peer that they can respect. So it's a whole different dynamic, and yet they're still looking for the same thing. And so we'll see those dynamics. So let's get into who are the millennials. The millennials are also known as Generation Y. They're usually categorized as those whose birth years began as early as the 1980s through the mid-1990s, all the way up to early 2000s. So you've got about a 20-year span, 1980s to 2000s. They are the children of the baby boomers, Generation X. Now, does anybody here know why baby boomers are called boomers? Anybody here know?
How many kids are being born after the war?
There was such a boom in the birth rate, so they call them baby boomers. So when you really start talking about marketing and business, or you start talking about church growth, you're really talking about high numbers in the boomer generation. Now, the millennial generation, there has been a deliberate effort to reduce the population. So when we start talking about numbers, now we're really talking about the boomer generation being that expansive number, and they didn't have as many children as their parents did. Okay, now the Generation X, the boomers were born in the early to mid-1940s, and ending anywhere from 1960 to 1964. The term millennials was coined in 1987 by William Strauss and Neil Howe around the time that children who were born in 1982 were in preschool and would be a part of the high school graduating class in the dawn of the new millennium. Therefore, they called them the millennials. Here are a few interesting facts about millennials that will help us later in our discussion. One, they are described by psychologist John Twing as Generation Me. We'll pause there. Generation Me. Now, a couple of factors that kind of produce this. Number one, smaller families. So since they have, since they were reared in smaller families, fewer siblings, they became accustomed to being spoiled. So there was a day where, when it relates to the church, people would join a church, and in joining the church, they would avail themselves to serve. Millennial generation joins a church to see what the church can do for them. Now that creates a different kind of paradigm when you talk about church growth. Many, most of you will remember when we had Sunday school, morning worship, afternoon service somewhere almost every Sunday.
Yes.
It was church anniversary, pastor anniversary, worship one anniversary, worship two anniversary, choir anniversary, missionary, Women's Day. Man, it was always somewhere to go. And then you had BTU.
Yes.
And evening service.
Okay.
And so Sunday was all day.
Well.
Now you've got a generation, they want to go to church, get it over, and have the rest of the day to themselves.
That's right. You're right.
Whole other paradigm. So now, here are some of the choices we have to make as congregations. Do we stick to our old paradigm and persecute millennials? Or do we adjust our paradigm, accomplish the same agenda, but adjust our methodology so that we can appeal to millennials?
Yes.
And because each church is autonomous, each congregation has to kind of deal with that issue.
That's right.
The Bible said that the old way has been tried and found to be good. Is that a purpose?
You have to find that one from me.
Okay.
That's one of those that I've heard, but I can't remember reading.
But that's the reason I ask, you know, if you've been doing something and it's been good, why change? That's the reason I was asking.
Yeah. And we'll get into that. We'll get into the whole notion of cultural shifts. A horse and buggy ministry is great for horse and buggy day.
There you go.
But a horse and buggy ministry in a technological age would become a museum of what church used to be like.
All right.
So if you don't make certain adjustments without losing the content of your message, if you don't make those adjustments, you just become a fossil.
You're right.
And sometimes it's hard to make those adjustments.
Mm-hmm.
Because sometimes we can major in minors and minor in majors. What's most important is that we get the message right. If we stick to the right message, that's what's critical. Methods can be adjusted. I shared with the congregation one time, I was talking to a lady in another state, and she said to me, leaving out of a class that she taught, college professor, she was leaving out of class, and she said, I just wanted to tell you such and such, dot, dot, dot. Now I've got to go into church. And I said, okay, church is that close to your campus? And she said, no, I'm in my car. I stream it every
week.
And so she streams on her technology their Bible study, and then she sends her tithe in through technology also.
Okay.
So she doesn't bring a check to the church. In fact, millennials will laugh at you if you pull out a check. What is that? She doesn't worry about bringing cash to church because she's using technology.
Mm-hmm.
And so now we can say, if we want to, our foreparents brought that check. They brought it to church. And they did it this way. And we can stick to it if we want to, but we're going to miss a lot of resources. So the fact of the matter is there's no scripture that would suggest that we have to pay by check.
Correct.
And so if we become dogmatic about that method, we can miss out on reaching people with the message because we're so loyal to an old method.
Mm-hmm.
Any questions on anything?
But what about this? Don't forsake the assembly somewhere in.
Yeah, that's Hebrews. Hebrews 9, I believe. Don't forsake the assembling of ourselves. Mm-hmm. And there is certainly that necessity for us to come together. And that necessity should not be overlooked.
Mm-hmm.
I do believe that part of our experience is not just worship, but it's also fellowship. So that's critical. But then what do you do if the option the person has is to not make it because of work or whatever?
Mm-hmm.
and streaming it, or us saying, no, you need to come.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so if if we have those options, I'd rather for them to see it online.
Mm-hmm.
Like I tell 23rd Street, we've got one church at least two locations.
Okay.
Because we have Bible study on Tuesday, and then we're showing it on Facebook Live at the same time.
Mm-hmm.
And sometimes we have more folk on Facebook Live than we do in the sanctuary.
Mm-hmm.
You know, so one church, two locations. So if they're getting the message, then that's what we kind of have to look at.
Okay.
Now, another thing that we have to also consider is small group settings. Now, we did the same thing. And millennials want to do it, but it looks different. So again, nothing has changed, it just looks different. We had small groups because, for instance, we had mission circles. And mission circles would meet sometimes in homes in different places. So it was a small group. Now, if you say to a millennial, a mission circle, they automatically leave. They don't want to talk about no mission circles, none of that. Mission number one, mission number two, they're not interested in that. Now you can have the same thing and give it a jazzy name.
Right, exactly.
We got a young adult ministry at the church, and I can't remember what name I had as an idea for it that I really liked.
Mm-hmm.
And out of respect to me, they said, yeah. I said, now that ain't what y'all want now. They said, okay. And they quickly came up with another name. They came up with Graffiti Faith. And for them, Graffiti Faith represents individual expression. Graffiti. You know, sometimes we can do that with our Sunday school classes. Give them names that indicate something more modern.
Okay.
I visited one church, and in their Sunday school, in some of their classes, it was set up less like a classroom and more like a living room. Yeah. And so when you come there, it feels like you're having a family discussion. And people enjoy it. Another thing that, and a lot of these things that I'm saying now, I'm actually moving into Thursday night, so if I repeat myself, that's not all happening. But one of the things we have to consider is even with our Sunday school. I personally am more attracted to Sunday school that is topically centered more than Sunday school book centered.
Okay.
Now that's my personal preference.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Because for me, if I am dealing with a particular issue in my life,
mm-hmm.
and Sunday school is giving me some biblical instruction on it, I want to be there.
Right.
Now, if I'm dealing with a particular issue and the lesson is in Ecclesiastes today and next Sunday is in John, that may not appeal to me.
Mm-hmm.
And so having that kind of diversity can be useful in reaching millennials also. Because we have to go back to the fact that he just said it's the me generation. They have questions. They want to know, number one, again, we're going to deal with this on the second page. They have some particular questions like, how can I, in this big world, because their world is larger than ours, how can I, in this big world, live out the American dream? And so if we're just talking about to them bank-sized, localized issues, we're not going to get it. Because they want it all. And we'll get back into that. But let's go to the second one. Following the boomer generation, there's been a deliberate effort to reduce the booming birth rate in the millennial generation. Now that's deliberate. When I say deliberate, I'm talking about people who are pulling strings behind the scenes whose names none of us know. They have said publicly that we have to reduce the population. And that's huge. We need to know that. The whole look of America is rapidly shifting.
Mm-hmm.
And we're going to see how, as a church community, we're going to have to become bilingual. trumpet, and they gonna get it.
You right.
It's shifting dramatically. Mm-hmm. The theory is that the problem with our climate is too much pollution. And there's so much pollution because of the increased population. So a lot of these laws that we're seeing and we're wondering why people are falling for them, line and sinker, it's because behind the scenes they're trying to reduce the population. If you can imprison more black men, then you automatically reduce the population in the black community. And so you take them out, and then you convince the black community that same-sex marriage is okay. So now you're still reducing the population.
Okay.
And then you tell them you can have the American dream. So now economics and finances become far more important than family. So now they want to get their piece of the pie. And we're going to see how in 2050 projections are that we as a race of people will be 13% of the population. But here's the catch. Hispanics will be 31%. So now you're talking about we remain the minority. But then there's another minority that outnumbers us. So when you start looking at those kind of demographics, now you start looking at population. I mean, you start looking at politics. You start looking at economics. You start looking at everything differently. And so one of the things that millennials have done, when I talked about how their world has expanded, technology expands their world. They can go on social media and communicate with celebrities almost as if they're friends. Tweet, Snapchat, Facebook.
All right.
They can have direct contact. So for them, somebody that's a celebrity that in previous generations was somewhere way up there, and if we got a chance to get close to them, oh, it was just an honor. Now they're taking pictures with them.
Mm-hmm.
Because their world has enlarged. So they don't see race relations the same way. Because for them, integration is a norm. Now I was born in 69 when Jesse Jackson ran for president. That was huge. He didn't have to win, just the fact that he ran and was considered a serious candidate. Well, they've seen a black man in the White House. So I actually had a young man ask me that one time, and y'all may remember this. He asked me, he said, when people keep talking about racism, is that an older generation just trying to keep stuff up? Or is this really real? And I was really dumbfounded by the question. I really didn't think he meant it as he said it. But he did. Because for that generation, racism to them is not a real big issue. And it takes video recordings of police brutality for them to kind of see it, but then a lot of them feel like they probably brought that on themselves. And so if we try to build a church centered around civil rights issues, we're going to lose the millennial generation because they are liberated from that. They're trying to get their two-car, three-car garage, their Caribbean cruises, their condominiums in the country, their creature comforts, and their cute companions. They ain't thinking about talking about we feel overcome. They have already overcome.
All right.
And when they deal with their own issues, it's usually individualized. Now notice how the churches that are mega churches in our nation, almost all of them focus on individual prosperity.
Does it?
Because it's not about community now. It's about individualism.
Yeah.
Because it's the me generation. And so there's a deliberate effort to reduce the population. And one thing that helps in it with our theological stance is that if I'm only focusing on myself, then I got to get mine first. I'll help you if I want to have to get mine. But I can get mine, you can get yours.
Amen.
And so we end up being a generation that says, if you're not helping me, I don't need you. How many of you have seen little memes and quotes on social media? Because I see them all the time. I try not to see them. They just always show up. The always focus is on if somebody ain't helping you, cut them off.
What they teaching y'all over there?
One of them says something like some celebrity had bought somebody a car, and another celebrity had bought somebody else a house, and then they said, "I got all these friends and they love me. When y'all gonna catch up?" Without understanding that that's diametrically opposed to the real definition of love. Love is a minimum of emotion, a maximum of the evaluation of need, and the coming together of the two in a spirit of self-sacrifice. Forfeiture of self and substance, personhood and possessions to benefit someone else. Which means love is not something I seek, it's something I seek to give. But not in the me generation. I'm trying to see how many folk love me. You love me and you bless me and you help me get to the next level. And when I get to the next level, I'll help you get to the next level too. And so we bring that kind of philosophy to church where people say, I want a sermon that helps me see myself going to the next level. I'll serve at the church, but not if it's going to inconvenience me too much. No, I'll serve at the nursery first Sundays for about 30 minutes. You know, but I can't do it every week because I'm going to sit with my family. We travel, so we may not be here on Sunday. And so they have these different things they're doing, and so you don't get the same kind of commitment that you used to have. And as a result, if you want to have commitment, you know what you got to do? You got to hire folks. And then if you're going to pay them, you want quality, so that means you might have to send them to school so they can get trained. Because it's a whole other generation. And then, of course, number three, technology is a critical norm in the life of the ladies. I was meeting some time ago. It was in that meeting. I think I was one of about three pastors. There were all of the colleges in Birmingham, the presidents of those universities were in the meeting. There were some judges, there were some attorneys, and we met three times a year. And someone says, well, because we don't meet often, we really need to come up with some way where we can meet, if we're traveling, we're out of town, where we can stream this. And so we spent about 20 minutes trying to figure out how we could set it up. And one college president says, you know, I don't know why we're having this discussion. I've got a son in middle school. He can probably set it up in about 5 minutes.
You're right.
Your telephone fixed, just give it to your great kid.
They can fix it. It's like they are wired for it. And so communication now is different. Because communication is swifter, so there are pros and cons. Communication is swifter. There was a time where if you weren't at home, you couldn't talk on the phone.
That's right.
And if you were on the phone, you were going to miss a call because if somebody called, it was going to be a busy city.
That's right.
Now you can be talking on the phone, texting on the same phone, and then on social media at the same time.
Multitask.
And And so it's a whole nother generation. So communication is swifter. But while it's swifter, people are often more distant from each other. Because you don't have to talk to folks. Right? I can text you. And it's so cool that I can text you any time of day. I'm a night owl. So I can text you at 1 o'clock. If you got your phone off, you ain't gonna see it till you wake up, so I ain't gonna wake you up. But at least when you wake up, you get it. But without that kind of technology, no, I had to wait till you wake up and call you at a respectable time. And so technology becomes huge. So then they talk about the areas that millennials use for social media. Twitter, Snapchat, YouTube, and the only one I'm using is Facebook, but I'm being told that's for us old folks.
Yeah, that's what they say. They say.
Yeah, Instagram. And so Facebook has become for us fossils.
Right. Amen.
And so a church then that's going to reach millennials, we need to be aware that they're using this. And it's a pivotal part of that moment by moment life. And so we've got to use it too. There's a group that I'm a part of. We have meetings actually every day. We have some days we meet twice a day. But we meet from my computer. Sometimes I teach the classes, and if I teach the classes, because we meet at 8:30 in the mornings, so if I teach the classes, then if I show myself visibly, I can have shirt and tie on top and my shorts at the bottom. All they gonna see is the neck up anyway. And I brag, I'm dressed up for y'all today. Y'all know I got flip flops on.
Either you can just tape it or whatever and not be there. They're still thinking.
Yeah. I mean, again, that's the age we're living in.
It is.
And so, you know, we talk about meeting, church meetings and all of that. What if we started having just an idea? I don't want any of you going to your pastors and saying that I said y'all should start doing this. Just an idea. What if you started having church meetings using technology? Okay, we're going to have whatever kind of meeting, trustee meeting, whatever. And so log in at 7 o'clock. Now, that may sound like something small, but when you're talking about a millennial group, I guarantee you get more participation. So a lot of them don't want to drive out to no church. They've been at work all day trying to make deals. They're getting their hustle on. And now they got families to tend to. And now you want them to drive out to a church. And if they go to the first meeting and the first meeting looks like a waste of time, they ain't coming back.
You are.
Because here's the other thing about them. They don't like them meetings. I don't want to sit in church all night listening to you argue about finances. Who should be president? They ain't interested in none of that. They feel like that's a waste of time, that God ain't in it, and they will leave that congregation to go to a church where they don't have to go to no meetings. If you've got a staff, the staff ought to be able to handle that. That's what they for. That's the way millennials are thinking. If we got a pastoral staff, that's what you on staff for. We come to church to have church and go home. So, you know, you start having too many meetings, you're going to lose them. Because they don't want to come to that. So if you want them to participate in the meetings, use technology. Because they like technology. They can do it from their car, they can do it from their living room, they can do it from their place of choice. Sometimes those meetings that I have, I go to the park, I'm in my car. Because if I'm at home, I can't keep still. I got to be moving. So if I'm in my car, I can sit there in the car and be fine. Sit in the car right in the park. So we got to start considering those things. And then number four, during the Boomer generation for African Americans, black culture was empowered. Phrases like James Brown, I'm black, I'm proud. Or Jesse Jackson's, I am somebody. Or Muhammad Ali, I am pretty. You see, what a lot of people don't recognize is that when Ali was talking about I am pretty, it was viewed as more than him just talking about himself. It was him also talking about the beauty of blackness. Millennials don't really wrestle with that. Because again, we've been integrated, or at least have this view of integration, where, you know, they feel pretty content with their blackness. In fact, black is the new cool.
I would, they might start coming over too, son.
And that's, you know, you see whites bathing themselves in the sun, trying to get some color. Yeah, because black is the new cool. So when we spend too much time on blackness, unless you've got some special kind of charisma, I know a few guys in pulpits who have that kind of charisma, but very few, usually you're going to lose that generation because they feel like you're trying to take them backwards. They're thinking about their own economic empowerment. And let me tell you something that happened to me years ago. I was preaching a revival in New York, and on one of those days, a group of pastors joined me and the host pastor for lunch. One of the pastors there was an older white pastor, and I can't remember his name, but he said something that struck me. He said, I've marched with Martin King in the 60s. He said, but after the 60s, some other white pastors pulled me and some others together. And they specifically said, we have to make sure that the black community never has another Martin Luther King. He said, now they didn't know how wedded I was to the movement, so I sat quiet just to listen. Someone said, well, how do we do that? He said, well, we have to make heroes of pastors who are not focused on community development. And right after that, they created some of these Christian television networks who would promote the ministries of pastors who focused on prosperity. So that prosperity began to be the emblem of success. So that now you don't look to someone like a Martin King who's talking about community development and trying to help those who are impoverished. It's all about those who are going to another level. Like one pastor told me, and I don't criticize him for it, but this is what he told me. Probably if I called his name, y'all would know him because he was having a television show, one of those reality shows. He said to me, he said, I've been called to help those in the middle go to the top. I didn't take issue with that. He's honest. What I took issue with was the next sentence. He said, I ain't studying about them Negroes at the bottom. And so that's kind of what we're looking at now. We're looking at a generation of folk who see themselves as middle class because they've got college degrees. Because what the mistake many of them have made that they learned from their parents is that they chose education over liberation. Now that's worth writing down. They got education and thought because of their degree they were middle class, but they're still in debt. I mean, if you're making $80,000 a year, but spending $85,000 a year, you're still broke.
You're still broke.
But they think they are middle class because of their degrees and because of the neighborhoods that they're in and the kind of cars they're driving that they finance all of. And so now they're trying to go to the top. So when they come to church, they don't want to hear a sermon about, you know, you got to struggle and you got to fight. But one day, Christ is coming back to take us home. They want heaven here on earth. They want to know when that breakthrough is coming. And when they talking about when, they looking at their watches, not a calendar. And so when we minister to them, we have to understand their psyche. And sometimes we have to reprogram them and get them to see that just because you have a degree or several degrees doesn't make you free. So any questions on that before we go to the next
thing? I have a question. Well, when do the teaching be done? I know a lot of times, I know at our church, people don't know when the scripture being written. People are walk. They are. I know when I was young, with the first song, you didn't come in to after the anthem. There's a lot of things that people do that they don't know. When did you get that training if you're going to be like this? When did you get that training?
And that's a challenge because we learned it in PTU.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm saying. But that's what I'm asking. When do you get that training? What to do and not to do?
And I think technology helps us again. I've seen churches who have those projectors of screens, and they'll tell you at certain times, please be seated. Please don't walk. So you use technology, just put it on the screen. Because they ain't coming back to PTU. So you have to, you know, again, think about it. How we used to have a clerk or the secretary read the announcements every Sunday. You'd lose every millennium if they had to sit through there every Sunday. So you got some important announcements, put it on screen. Don't read it. Because those. But they want short services. And the thing is, they can be brief as long as you don't take out the necessary stuff. Like, don't have a 30-minute offering and a 10-minute sermon.
Put it on your schedule.
One of the things that happened for Citywide Revival this year is that they couldn't get as many choirs as they wanted because so many churches now don't have choirs. You got priests in it. Because a choir stand and a choir, that looks too old, traditional, back in the day. And so they want a sanctuary that does not look like a traditional church. It looks like an auditorium.
No church building.
And you've got a stage where the choir performs and the pastor gives his motivational message.
I know, but he said it's true. Not alone just a millennial. I used to talk to daughters all the time. He said, y'all just back in the day. So he's into technology, just like you say. He's a firefighter, so he didn't get to come. You know what you're talking about. So he watches on the screen. Plus, going there too. They don't see race. He's engaged to a white lady. So he don't want to come there because not to make her feel uncomfortable. He's not going. So they found something in between. It's in between what both of them could be accomplished. It's just like you said, it's about, it's a me mentality.
Yeah.
That's what it is. It really is. And I said, well, mama, I went to church at home. That's how I was at church at home. I watched it on the television. You know, I watched it on the screen. All of that, I struggled with that for a long time. I just talked to God about it. A lot. Because I said, mama, I said, well, why? I said, if you don't come here to find somebody to do it, y'all just too far back in the day, mama. Y'all just way back there. Everybody do that stuff with y'all. Do. See, and it is hard to try to tell them. You don't really know how to prove them back that way. It's hard. That's why I came to this place. It's so hard to do that because they're looking at all he has among this nothing but technology. He has a camera that can take my picture today and send it to my phone the same day, the same next minute. That's what sent it to me. It's on there, mama. Like that. So it's a struggle for me. That's why I came, because I want to know, get some ideas on how you can minister to them, because it's rough. It's hard. And he got that mentality of, if I called him, he'd say, yeah, you called me. I'm like, I'm old fashioned. I want you to come see me. Mama, I stay in here, Lena. I'm not coming away. That's how he is, you know. And I'm like, for your mama. Mama, that's a long drive. I'm talking on FaceTime, Instagram. That's the mentality. It really is.
Yeah, and I was saying that technology is also showing
the attention span. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. And that goes back to the show.
Technology has shortened the attention span of millennials.
Yeah, because everything is right away.
I would say so.
I think everything has virtues and vices.
Yeah.
And that's why we have to use it without diluting the message. Because that's the thing. I've seen people switch churches, and the messages at each church is different, and they don't even know it. Because it's not even about the message. No. Do you have something for my kids? My kids like it. We love this church. It may not have anything to do with the teaching of that church.
They just said, well, my kids love going there. Nieces and nephews, they love going there. They just like it. They like the Jordan, that's where the Jordan day. They like all that stuff like that.
See, that's the thing we run into. Certainly, I don't want to get into the politics of this. That's what we run into with the church. They've got the resources to be modern.
Yes.
And we know a lot of people are going to leave traditional churches going there because of the projection, the image. And there may be some political problems beneath the surface that they don't see. And by the time they see it, they're going to be blind.
Now, they said that they pastor is not fair. You know, he just takes everything and they just go look at this.
It's true.
And you can wear whatever you want to wear. If you want to come in your night clothes, you know, you can.
Coke and popcorn.
Yes.
They have different campuses.
And again, it shows technology.
Yes.
They're using it. So we can condemn it, or we can say, you know what? I'm not going to lose my message.
There you go.
But I'm going to change my method.
Right. Change your method.
You're going to get into this later. We got to go. But what is it if you invite them to share and they just won't come forward? Or to get them to commit to them being in charge of that? They don't want to listen to me, but they don't want to commit for the age, you know, that they want to be part of.
And that's again the problem, because I am, and I have been for years. Yeah, that's why we set up the Feed of Faith. Y'all got the ideas and y'all got the skills. Have at it. But because it's a mid-generation, they don't want to commit that
down.
All right, we reassemble. I know y'all have a good time. It's time to come.